My name is David Frias. I'm the co-coordinator of the San Francisco Native Wage. We welcome and thank you for coming tonight for this benefit concert. This American social justice indie folk singer, guitarist, songwriter, worker troubadour, who has carried on the venerable American musical tradition of penning ballads in tribute of the working men and women. Compared to the great Bill Arts, recommended for listening by the late Pete Seeger, by the end of this concert, he will make you laugh, he'll make you cry, and make the revolution irresistible. Let's introduce David Rovics to the stage.
Not only for existing, but for being able to competently promote a concert. It's wonderful.
All right.
It's a very good sign. Yeah. It's so nice to play in theaters, but it's especially nice when there's an audience. The risk of theaters is they're bigger than living rooms, and so, you need more than 10 people to amplify. We'll try a song and see if it sounds all right out there. A song inspired by watching one too many Republican debates. I turned to my TV, though it was hard to see these men who would be head of state. What a great country, from sea to sign we see, we watch the Republicans debate. Newt stood with his third wife and said, you bet your life the president is a red. He wants to tax the rich a lot, take your limo and your yacht. He wants to have the bankers' heads. And if he gets in again, he'll paint the White House pink and then he'll hire Chavez as his VP. Then we'll be right on track to give capitalism the sack along with the insurance industry. If only it were true. It's only a sing-along after the song's over and you've learned the chorus. He'll give everyone food stamps and wheelchair ramps. He'll subsidize windmills and maple syrup. He'll cripple industries with eco-friendly policies, and pretty soon we will be just like Europe. He'll shut down oil wells and give out solar cells to every home in Delaware and Illinois. He'll ban in the parks, he'll send the works of Karl Marx to the homes of every American girl and boy. He'll abolish pesticides, he'll be giving out free rides and free lunches to his high-speed trains. He'll start lots of public works full of union perks. He'll fill the cities up with bicycle lanes. If only it were true, if only it were true, I'd be so happy. This shall be our death knell. He'll pull the troops out and end all of our wars. He'll love military spending. Our empire will be ending and soon we'll be invaded by the Moors. He'll legalize all drugs, give away beer mugs and hookahs to every child and Korans. He'll ban religions from the schools, give 40 acres and a mule to every person who makes less than 50 grand. He'll close Guantanamo to torture. He'll say no. He'll make us all drive electric cars. He'll reinstate the fairness doctrine, take off that damn flag pin, and he'll put Rupert Murdoch behind bars.
Yeah.
Iceland a few months ago, and there's still banks in Iceland too, although the people that used to run them are in prison. Yeah. Iceland is an island with 500,000 or so Vikings, mostly known for volcanoes, hot springs, and fishing, known for its welfare state for being good and socialistic. Certainly not known for being corrupt or nepotistic, but in the USA and Europe, when they were deregulating banks, Iceland's politicians took bribes and joined their ranks. So yeah, situation one would think just couldn't be. A bank whose debt was worth 10 times the country's GDP. When Wall Street imploded, sure enough it spread. Banks all over the world were floating in the red. All over the world, governments made a plan to cut spending and raise taxes on the working woman and working man. The banks were bailed out while the people had to pay. But in Iceland, people thought there must be a better way. And the earth stood still a moment. Fear was struck in every top. When Iceland told the bankers, Iceland told the bankers, Iceland told the bankers to fuck off. Folks were in the streets in Reykjavik and just couldn't be ignored. They said this is a debt we Icelanders can't afford. Let's guarantee deposits of all our people, yes indeed. But as for all the speculators motivated by their greed to make really dumb investments, to them Iceland said good luck. Sorry for your losses, but we don't really give a fuck. The 1% all trembled when they took away the trough. When Iceland told the bankers, Iceland told the bankers, Iceland told the bankers to fuck off. The UK called them terrorists, said we cannot let this stand. Who do these peacenik blondes think they are in Iceland? They threatened isolation and economy in flames. But the Icelanders said sorry, but the banks can settle their own claim. Well, that might be harder for them now that they're under house arrest. Or else they fled the country as they were most unwelcome guests. And now Reykjavik's recovery just makes the fat cats sputter and cough. Since Iceland told the bankers, Iceland told the bankers, Iceland told the bankers to fuck off. If you haven't heard of this example, perhaps there is a reason why the owners of the world don't want this kind of shit to fly. They say we all must pay up in this shakedown by the mob if we can't afford to pay the rent because we don't have a job. They say it's not their problem if we're forever shackled by their debt. We must save the 1% from the fate they should have met. But there is an alternative, though it makes the fat cat scoff, that Iceland told the bankers. Iceland told the bankers. Iceland told the bankers to fuck off. Iceland told the bankers. Iceland told the bankers. Iceland told the bankers to fuck off. So when I got to Iceland, I was only there for 16 hours actually, but it was a long enough visit. You know, if you go to the right places, you can find stuff out. And I knew about Iceland, how Iceland dealt with the financial crisis. And but what I didn't had never heard of until I got there that time a few months ago was what people talk about as the beginning of the environmental movement in Iceland, which they say started around 1970, and it was pretty much began as a protest movement against the building of a large dam. And there's a documentary about it that looks really good, but as far as I know, it does not exist with non-Icelandic subtitles, so it's a bit, somebody needs to work on that. Beside a volcano and the rising ash, the crystal river rushing past, the crystal river flowing free, now again like it used to be. Since now the dam is out of sight, blown apart by dynamite, blown apart by everyone in the land of the midnight sun. 100 farmers the next day called the cops so they could say, if you're looking for one to blame, 100 farmers gave their names. Gave their names, said it was I, who couldn't just stand idly by. We all knew that sometimes you must commit a crime. There was a blast, a booming sound, and the band came crashing down. In Reykjavik, voices shrill said the dam should be bigger still. By the Laxa riverside, 100 farms would be washed aside. Legal efforts and protests failed, but they still had air behind their sails. They had air and dynamite, so they gathered round it one night. There was a a booming sound, and the dam came crashing down. Prosecutors tried to choose which farmers had lit the fuse, but not a one would tell the tale, and not one farmer went to jail. The dam was never built again. Remember when by the Laxa River they set things right with a couple sticks of dynamite. There was a blast, a booming sound, and the dam came crashing down. There was a blast, a booming sound, and the dam came crashing down. Crashing down. Produce, if you can call it that, of the tar sands in Alberta and the fracking oil from North Dakota, and moving it all over North America in trains, including Richmond, California. Of course, these trains go through the city center because they were originally meant to transport things like human beings and lettuce. You know, and there's an oil boom. Berries are on fire. Shale gas. All the fuel you might desire coming out so fast. No time to lay pipeline. Eureka built. It's like the days of 49, except this time they're using massive rigs that poison everything northward. The deeper that it digs, trains a mile long, loaded up in rail cars, send them west, send them east, past cafe schools, late night bars. There's an oil train coming through your town. There were dangers. They knew this from the start, but they were minimal. They said everyone must play their part and risk the destruction of their cities. each time a train rolls by, hoping won't derail and detonate sky high. There's an accident each day somewhere, but we're not supposed to fear that it could happen here. Listen closely. Do you hear that whistle blow? Look out the window. Do you see the fire glow? There's an oil train coming through your town. It was after midnight on a Saturday night. A resident called it that a rail car with a light with that much gas. Sitting by the lake, it was no one's job to watch the car that maintained the brake on 73 massive tanks of fracking gas down the hill, gaining speed as they rolled past. Now at the music cafe that once was on Rue Frontenac, there are 50 customers and employees who won't be coming back. There's an oil train coming through your town. There's an oil train coming through your town. There's a lot of alternatives. When I was, we were passing through Mendocino and stayed at the home of one of the folks who was involved with the Alliance for Democracy and the magazine they put out, Jim, and they have they have a couple of solar panels on the roof, and their electricity bill last year was $13. I think the technology's improved a lot, and they actually even power a car with that. Of course, one of the solutions is not nuclear power, and back the. Of course, we're coming right up to the anniversary of the horrible Fukushima disaster. And one of the, when the 60s and 70s, when everybody around the world, all the rich countries anyway, were all building nukes, nuclear reactors, Denmark was not doing that. And not because there weren't people who wanted to do that, but because of the social movement. Social is why good things happen. It was in the 1970s. The fuel crisis had begun. Choices were presented to us as if we had none. Leaders of industry said they could solve the problem by mastering the power of the radioactive atom. Some folks in Western Jutland got a notion in their heads. They thought there might be something they could offer up instead. A few hundred people gathered at a little place called Finn and declared their will to harness the power of the wind. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. There were many who said their science wasn't sound, that such a mighty windmill would simply topple to the ground. Some of them were scientists, the vast majority were not, but they knew with years of effort you could do a lot. Word about the project spread far and wide. 100,000 visitors came to help and to advise. Until one day these windmill builders drove in with a crane and lifted up their giant wings with a mighty chain. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. When Twincraft was completed, it reached up to the sky. its wings churned in the air. At 54 meters high, the critics all fell silent. No one now was jeering, as even industry agreed. This was some damn fine engineering. The wind reeking old Jutland from the North Atlantic Sea, as it was seamlessly converted into electricity. It was power for the people, leukemia for none, when they declared in Denmark, just south of the midnight sun, "We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world." They gave away the patents. They said knowledge should be free. And their plans were copied by a newborn industry. Soon Denmark would be known as a windmill building nation. And it all started with some hippies at the Tvindkraft power station. Debates were held in parliament about which way things should go. Build a nuclear reactor, the majority said no. It could have gone quite differently in much of the world it did, except for those in Ulfborg who said we're getting off the grid. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. Built, there was a war between the United States and Great Britain, which was started by the U.S., although in our history books they usually try to gloss over that fact, but the U.S. invaded Canada in an unprovoked attack and burned to the ground Canada's biggest city, York, which is now Toronto. And they destroyed every building that were in the center of the city, including the homes of people, not just official buildings. And this was the U.S. strategy for winning the hearts and minds of the Canadian public. And for some reason, it didn't work. You know, after hundreds of years of trying the same strategy to win hearts and minds, you'd think they could like adjust it slightly, you know. Perhaps carpet bombing is the wrong approach. No, it's here. Then England naturally got involved, which took a while because England was a long way away, and so much of the War of 1812 actually happened in 1814. So this coming summer is the 200th anniversary of that bit of the war. And I was visiting a wonderful songwriter in Ireland named Tommy Sands, and he and his brother Colin both live in the former horse stables of the Ross family in Ross Trevor, County Down in Ireland, which is a town that was named after the Ross family. It had a different name before. But he was asked, he gets some strange requests for writing songs. He's very much involved with the peace process, although his family is very much decidedly a family of Catholic tenant farmers living on a wealthy estate of a Protestant. But he's been involved with the peace process for most of his adult life, and he was asked by the town council to write a song about the most well-known member of the Ross family, General Robert Ross, for whom there's a phallic monument in the center of town. And he just couldn't come up with any redeeming qualities about the guy to write about, because he didn't want to write a hatchet song kind of thing. He wanted to write something, you know, more that could be appreciated by both sides, as they would say there. And when he couldn't rise to the occasion, I thought, you know, I think I've got an angle for this, because I knew about General Robert Ross and his greatest accomplishment in life, or at least the one for which he's most remembered, and I thought, I could, you know, Tommy might alienate his Irish-American audience by singing the song, but I'm not worried about alienating my audience, because my audience is already thoroughly alienated. Robert Ross was from Ross Trip. He was born in County Down. His family was given land there by the British Crown. He was a man born of the gentry, born with wealth and fame, but he joined the British Army to serve his queen and make his name. In the Napoleonic Wars, he fought in many lands, in Holland and in Spain, in the far-off Egyptian sands. He was wounded there in battle, came back to fight another day, and he was sent off to attack the USA. York had been sacked and burned by invading Yankee men, but the Canadians regrouped, chased the Yankees home, and then the British Navy made its way to the shores of D.C. town, where General Ross burned the White House down. The year was 1814. The U.S. was in retreat. It was a Canadian victory, an American defeat. Without the French to help them, they got their ass whipped by the Crown when General Ross burned the White House down. The place had just been constructed only 12 years before, but it had to be rebuilt soon after this disastrous war. The president turned pale and ran like a raggedy clown when General Ross burned the White House down. He was killed a few months later. Irish rebels stopped him in his tracks. He was buried in Nova Scotia in the town of Halifax. He might have been forgotten, but he'll forever be renowned. He's the man who burned the White House down. He's the man who burned the White House down. So I think I was, somehow or other thinking about it again and reading about it last summer about the movement in the 1840s in upstate New York that led to, I mean, one of the movements that led directly to the existence of a middle class in this country. And, if you grew up west of the Mississippi, you know, and you come from a white family, then you, in all likelihood, were a beneficiary of the Homestead Act of 1862. If your family dates back that far. You know, of course, most of them don't. They came from, like much of my family, they came in the 1890s. But the other half of my family came in the 1890s, escaping the pogroms, and the other half came earlier than that, escaping the potato famine. And then some of the others came before that, and they were the English. But before the English, they were the Dutch, you know. And much of this country was just given away to rich people, and then they called themselves landlords, you know. And the rest of us were tenants, and it hasn't really changed. Of course, the reason why the Homestead Act of 1862 happened was not because of the, sort of benevolent leanings of the aristocracy. It was because of the rent strike. For 9 years, nobody paid the rent in upstate New York. Thank you. the river shore. He invited families to move in and give him 30% of everything they grew every year. This is how they pay the rent. His name was Rensselaer. He became one of the richest men on earth. In today's terms, $90 billion is how much he'd be worth. All this for doing nothing but saying all of this was his. I have the power of the state behind me, and I'm in the landlord biz. After 200 years of this and one revolution won, another Rensselaer had another son. And this Rensselaer was greedier than his ancestors dead and past. It was the 1840s, and things were changing fast. It was the straw that broke the back. The bottle was uncorked. They started organizing meetings, the tenant farmers of New York. They found the strength of numbers. They found the power of suggestion. They found each other asking the same question. Who gave you the right to be a landlord, to live a life of ease while others toil? Who gave you the right to be a rich man while the rest of us pay you so we can work this soil? They vowed they would stop the rent collection. They vowed they'd bring this madness to an end. And when one blew the tin horn of distress, he soon found he had a thousand friends. With calico skirts, masks upon their faces, on horseback armed with knives and guns. They chanted and they yelled and they kept their farms and they kept the sheriffs on the run. They asked, who gave you the right to be a landlord? But nothing could be done to break their will. And by 1848, the landlords buckled, sold their holdings to the farmers in the hills. Yes, they overthrew this feudal system, but it's replaced now by speculators and banks. And you can still hear the homeless families asking of all the landed gentry in our ranks, who gave you the right to be a landlord?
Being on the watch list that I'm on is I always have an empty seat next to me on the plane. So it's a very convenient watch list. I mean, being on the no-fly list would really suck. I would kind of embrace the idea, and then I'd just have to start touring by bicycle or something. I don't know, but you know, just go all the way in the other direction. But then somewhere below the no-fly list is whatever list I'm on, which, you know, so I don't know if it has a name. I'm sure it does, but we don't know what it is. But it's the list that gives you an empty seat on all the flights. It must be an expensive list. I always feel really kind of good when I fly. Like, I know I'm burning carbon, but at the same time, it's like, I know that somebody is spending money on that ticket. I mean, because I imagine it's not the airlines. I'm just guessing that the airlines, they have to have a flight, an air marshal on all their flights, and so I think he's supposed to be sitting next to me, but I think most of the flights clearly don't have an air marshal on them, because otherwise, why would the one empty seat on the entire plane be the one next to me all the time? You know? Because flights are busier, they're more full than usual, you know, because of the economy and whatever, and so it's often that the only empty seat is next to me. And but that gives me two seats to watch the movie on, but I get kind of comfortable, almost comfortable. I bet you saw this movie, I wrote the song about it. Was a man who had a little girl. She was the swan and only daughter. Not every oyster has a little pearl, but this one did. They lived by the water on the eastern side of San Francisco Bay, where the mountains meet the ocean. Together there they would greet the day by fruit veil station. Now the trains seem louder than they used to be there by the Oakland Ocean side. When you look out at the horizon now, what do you see since the day your daddy died? Dropped her off at school for the day. Looked for work, tried to make some money. Obstacles, roadblocks in the way. In this land of milk and honey, Dad and Mom went out one winter night. Their only plan to greet the new year. Fireworks and blunts, it's only right. Till 2009 was here. They were coming back from the celebration on a train that rode beneath the rising tide. They got off at Fruitvale Station on the day your daddy. They just wanted to go home and go to bed. They stepped off the train onto the platform. Punches thrown, angry words were said. Then came the men in uniform, face down, cuffs behind his back. No way to fight or run. That's the time the cop chose to attack. That's when he fired his gun. Prayers were prayed as the sun rose. Now his mama cried. Time stood still, the world froze on the day your daddy died. On the day your daddy died. in some parts of the country, depending on the audience, this song requires some kind of an introduction, and in San Francisco, it does not.
I don't drive a car because they run on gas, but if I did, it'd run on biomass. I ride a bike, or sometimes a skateboard, so fuck off all you drivers and your yuppie boards. Sitting all day in the traffic queues, I'm a better anarchist than you. I don't eat meat, I just live on holy chives or the donuts that I found. The people in that restaurant, I think, are so sad when you could have been eating bagels like the ones that I just had. I think it is a shame all the bourgeois things you do. I'm a better anarchist than you. I don't wear leather, and I like my clothes in black, and I made a really cool hammock from a moldy coffee sack. I like to hop on freight trains. I think that is so cool. It's so much funner doing this than being stuck in school. I can't believe you're wearing those brand new shiny shoes. I'm a better anarchist than you. I don't have sex, and there will be no sequel, because heterosexual relationships are inherently unequal. I'll just keep on moshing to anti-flag and crass until there are no differences in gender, race, or class. All you brainwashed breeders, you just haven't got a clue. Stupid notions like a representative democracy, whether or not it works. I know it is the case that only direct action can save the human race. So when I see you in your voting booth, then I know it's true. I'm a better anarchist than you. I am not a pacifist. I like throwing bricks, and when the cops have caught me and I've taken a few licks, I always feel lucky if I get a bloody nose, because I feel so militant and everybody knows. By the time the riot is all through, I'm a better anarchist than you. I'm a better anarchist than you.
I don't have any copies of it right now, but this is for my children's CD. Sort of union organizing for 5-year-olds.
I went to play at the playground to do things I like so much. Run with my friends, play make-believe, swing on the swings and such. But this morning I went to the playground, and bullies were guarding the swings. They knocked over the slide, dumped out the sandbox, took away all of our things. This playground is run by bullies, and they're all so big and mean. But this playground was made for all of us, and we're gonna change this scene.
Across the way, and we blocked that factory gate. games. Cause this world is run by bullies, and they're all so big and mean. But this world was made for all of us, and we're gonna change this scene. This world is run by bullies, and they're all so big and mean. But this world was made for all of us, and we're gonna change this scene.
A song that places like this always remind me of all the history that's gone on in buildings like this. Do a song about a good friend of mine named Bob Stick. I know that you knew people like Bob.
They were old when I was young, now they all but passed away. Now it's just a secondhand memory of the day when from all around the world they sailed off to Spain to fight against the fascists, where so many men were slain.
Or on a veterans parade, you could see the men who made the journey.
bold face, but the finest communist I've known lived to 95, and he spent his whole life striving for humanity to thrive. To forget these fallen heroes is something I cannot abide. Now that the last Lincoln veteran died, Spain called Arama. It's a place that we all know so well. It was there that we gave of our manhood, where so many of our brave comrades fell.
Gig on a brief tour of California, and when we were in Santa Barbara, all these gigs are just one of the most wonderful things about doing this for a living is that some of the greatest people you'll ever meet are coming to these shows and organizing these shows. It's very humbling. The guy who organized the show in Santa Barbara. Professor Richard Flax, he probably the most notoriety he had in his life in terms of media attention was in 1969 when he was hired the first time to teach at UCSB, and Governor Ronald Reagan said about his hiring Richard Flax to teach at the UC system is like hiring an arsonist to work in a firecracker factory. So one of the founding members of SDS, and one of the other folks who was there was a guy I mainly associate with Wisconsin, one of the most knowledgeable people on Wisconsin history you'll ever meet, named Ben Mansky. And back in Madison, they called him the Mansky with the Plansky, because he was a really kick-ass organizer since he was a teenager, and he came to. He came to the United States at the age of, I believe, 13, and it was a roundabout route for his family. His family followed a path that took them from Poland to Lithuania to Siberia to Japan to China to Palestine, and then eventually to the U.S., Palestine, Israel, and Wisconsin. And a few years ago, I was there in Madison, and he told me the story about how his grandfather made it out of Poland. And I believe, what year was that, 39? So it was all because of a Japanese diplomat. He was raised in Gifu, on the islands of Japan. He was sent off to Manchuria. That's how this tale began. His next assignment in the diplomatic corps was far off Lithuania and the European war. My grandfather was from Krakow. The Nazis came, he fled. He took his family to Vilnius so they might not end up dead. But the Panzers were advancing, and they knew they had to go. But he had to have a visa, and all the embassies said no. There was only one final possibility. The last consulate left open, the Third Reich's Asian ally. There in Lithuania,
there was no time to lose. They came looking for a visa, thousands of Polish Jews. The diplomat called Tokyo, can I grant you this reprieve? Three times he got his answer, tell them all to leave. He looked into their eyes, talked to his family. He and his wife decided they must set these people free. Although I never met him, and all was said and done, I am Sugihara-san. Disobeying orders that they knew to be wrong, Senpo and Yukiko started writing all day long. A month's worth of visas in every 20-hour day. Senpo and Yukiko could turn no refugee away. Word came from the empire, it's time to turn it in. You're closing down your consulate and moving to Berlin. They knew they did the right thing, of this they had no doubt. They threw visas out the window as the train pulled out. Although I never met him, when all is said and done, I am Sugihara-san. My grandfather crossed Siberia for five times the normal cost, fearing for the future. With every minute lost, he got the ferry to Kobe, then to occupied Shanghai. There he spent the war years, while back home his people died. Sugihara-san did not seek praise from anyone. When he died, the papers said, his neighbors knew not what he'd done. There are 40,000 people living lives today. Without Senpo Sugihara, I'd not be here now to say. Although I never met him, when all is said and done, I am Sugihara-san.
You can't get out of college, basically. But, yeah, if you look them up, you'll find some good stuff on the web, I'm sure. Well, here's more recently, here's a song about a true story about what happened to me last August. Tangentially related. I was stuck in Japan anyway. I should be gigging in New Zealand now, but I'm not. I'm stuck at Narita instead. I should be singing in Dunedin, smoking kiwi pot and chilling with the kiwi reds. But when I showed up at the airport to board my flight, I was handed somebody's cell phone. Suddenly the future didn't look so bright and I entered the twilight zone. The woman on the line said, hello, I'm from immigration. You may have a ticket, but you can't go to our great island nation. I felt like I'd been hit in the face with a big old kiwi log. But then I felt the
Anastasi's cold embrace when she said, I've been reading your blog. The spies are reading my blog. The introduction and the prologue. And if that's so, it just might be true that they're watching this video too. Well, I normally don't get many views, a few hundred friends and kooks. So it comes as surprising news that some of them are Kiwi spooks. I try to get my missives out and cause some small commotion. Someone's listening now, there's no doubt, across the South Pacific Ocean. The spies are reading my blog, the introduction and the prologue. And if that's so, it just might be true that they're watching this video too. Were you strip searched in Trondheim, she asked. What kinds of things do you smoke? Have you ever been charged with a crime? Are you rich or are you broke? Have you ever been turned away from any borders you tried to cross? What kind of venues did you plan to play? Do you use dental floss? I said, it seems a bit unusual for you to do things quite this way. I asked her, is this normal? But she wouldn't say. She'd just repeat her message. At night reading, you shall remain. I've read your blog, each vile passage, and you may not board that plane. The spies are reading my blog, the introduction and the prologue. And if that's so, it just might be true that they're watching this video too. They're watching this video too.
Spies are in the news a lot lately. You know, I think they like to say that, you know, that the President of the United States is the most powerful man in the world, which is, you know, a load of shit, really. But, the corporations that control them are usually a lot more powerful. But, you know, sometimes I feel like that some of the most powerful people in the world today are really Glenn Greenwald and Laura Poitras, you know. I mean, thanks to Edward Snowden, but, you know, for being able to this. But the timing that Greenwald has in releasing these little tidbits is just phenomenal. It's just like, I just can imagine what a great time he's having there, sitting around in Brazil, like, let's see, what's on Obama's schedule now? Meeting with the Brazilian Prime Minister? Oh, yeah, okay. Send, you know. By the way, he's been listening to your phone conversations up until yesterday, you know? It's just fantastic. Every time. They don't seem to know what is out there, you know? So it's like every time something happens, you know, but you don't know. Is Greenwald gonna fuck this up? You know, but President Trump. No. A secretive government had a secret operation, massacring villages, killing millions, secretly bombing entire nations. They wiretapped a hotel room, got caught, and the government was deposed because of secret documents Daniel Ellsberg exposed. One government came down to prevent a repetition of this fact. The next government passed the Freedom of Information Act. Each administration since then hoped it would go away. Then they finally seized the chance on a September day. They passed the Patriot Act before a single congressman had read it. But don't ask the executive how they interpret it, because that itself is secret, never to be revealed, just like their secret prisons and all the torture they concealed. Then they formed the PRISM program so they wouldn't even have to ask compliant corporations to assist them in the task of collecting information, every email you ever wrote, every book you ever read, every call you ever made, everything you ever said. I looked into a PRISM. What did I see? A police state looking back at me. The secret government then lied to congressional committees. Secret information, even a senator can't see. Secret bureaucrats working with secret corporations, enforcing secret laws, forming secret juries to serve a secret cause. I looked into a prism. What did I see? A police state looking back at me. One brave man came forward and then he fled town. Now the secret
government men mean to hunt him down. Feinstein says he's a traitor. McConnell says so too. But I'd say if we have a future, it's because of the whistle that he blew. I looked into a prism. What did I see? A police state looking back at me. I looked into a prism. What did I see? A police state looking back at me.
Mainly in the 19-teens.
We have fed you all for 1,000 years, yet you hail us still unfit. Though there's never a dollar, hails the workers dead. Given our best to give you rest, and you lie on crimson gold. If blood be the price of all your love, good God, we have paid it for. There's never a mind-blown skyward now, we're buried alive for you. There's never a wreck drift shoreward now, but we are its ghastly crew. Go reckon our dead by the forges red and the factories where we spin. If blood be the price of your cursed wealth, good God, we have paid it.
Come all of you workers, toil night and day.
For no more than your grip, have left for your country and counting your dead in the shipyards and mines. Factories and mines, we've often been told to keep up with the times, for our skills are not needed. They streamline the town and with slide and stopwatch our pride, they have robbed. And when the sky darkens, prospect is war, who's given a gun and then sent to the fore and expected to die. For the land of our birth, though we've never owned one handful of earth. We're the first ones to starve, we're the first ones to die, we're the first ones in line for that pie in the sky, and we're always the last. When the cream is shared out for the workers working, when the fat cat's about, yes, and all of these things. The worker has done from tilling the fields to carrying the gun, the yoke to the plow. Since time first began, it always expected to carry the can.
Over the past year that are, I mean, well worth mentioning. And now I do want to do a song about one of them. There was I was on a tour that took me around the circumference of the globe last fall, and except for New Zealand, there was supposed to be 13 countries, it ended up being 12. And there were elections taking place. Everywhere I was going, and it's the bane of the left to participate in these elections, which you never get them anywhere, just about, except for maybe Richmond, California. Every once in a while, you know, Seattle, and we got one city councilor. That's good. That's a start.
Yeah.
I mean, not to make little light of it. It's a big start, you know, but. We'll be happier once the socialists are in the majority. But elections are more than anything good for entertainment and good for distracting your audience from, you know, doing things like coming to your shows, you know, because they're out campaigning. You know. So they were having elections when I was passing through Australia for most of my tour, and the gigs started getting well attended at the end of the elections were over, of course. And same thing happened in Germany, but at least one Australian who was running for office had to leave the race that she was in because she said on national television that she did not mind Islam as a country. That was a swift move there. And then she tried to apologize for that statement. She seemed to realize that she had said something off, and she said, But Jews are okay because they follow Jesus. Which was news to the Jews of Australia. But the mayor of Toronto made for some good entertainment. Whenever, you know, politicians that are supposed to be tough on crime are caught smoking crack, it's always memorable. But I think the former congressman from the 4th District of Manhattan wins the prize. Anthony Weiner takes pictures of his leader and sends them off to lots of women that he's never met. Normally I wouldn't care about some guy's pubic hair, except in this case it's a politician we can hopefully soon forget. He wants to make New Yorkers proud, I'm sure he's very well endowed to be the mayor of the city from which he sends his tweets. He's a good Democrat, he'll go up to bat for the people of New York and the random women that he greets. Anthony Weiner's wiener, these days it's all the rage to find out more about his
his wiener, just take a peek at the front page. I probably wouldn't give a shit about his adolescent wit, whether he was sexting after he resigned from Congress or before. I may not like his style as he issues his denial, but what really bugs me is he voted for the war. Now Anthony Weiner's wiener, these days it's all the rage. To find out more about his wiener, just take a peek at the front page. Now that it's the second scandal, maybe we can pull the handle and send Anthony and his wiener down some flushing drain and await the politician next, who will send a penile text. One vile politician down, but far too many still remain. Anthony Wiener's wiener, these days it's all the rage. To find out more about his wiener, just take a peek at the front page. Days have been quite worrying. I don't know exactly, I don't really have a whole lot of opinion on whether the Crimea belongs to Ukraine or Russia personally. But I have strong opinions about the President of the United States threatening to take military action. Submarine. They were on patrol in international waters.
terrifying scene.
They were out of radio contact, deep beneath the water, when the sub began to shake and crack. The captain said, arm the nuclear torpedoes. We're under attack. The Americans were bombing them, but in order to respond, three officers had to give the go. Two were in agreement.
For some reason, the vice admiral said no. On the day the sun saved the world. On the day the sun saved the world. Thing you can do with an American military base is trespass on it with a sledgehammer. I was stranded in Japan waiting to see if I could get into New Zealand, and eventually didn't, and then got to Australia, and a friend of mine from Queensland said, we got a trial going on over here, we need a song for it. Watched it on the TV. Machine guns fired towards the ground. I watched the people run. Helicopter gunship strafing the street. I watched them lining up the bodies in the Baghdad heat. They say these leaks had consequences. Now I must agree, when I saw them fire on children, it affected me. I thought, what if I were wearing the other shoe? If I had a hammer, what would I do? I am just a person, like anyone. Another mother's son. I have no special powers. I cannot fly. Not like that helicopter gunship up in the sky. Sending all those bullets all around to the journalists and children. I am just one man, that's very true. But if I had a hammer, what would I do?
If you had a hammer, what would you do?
San Francisco Living Wage Coalition, to Carl and David and everybody who put this together. And thanks so much for the Labor Temple for still being here. And and if you want to really support what I'm doing in a big way, for the past year I've been on a campaign to get people to subscribe to me, which basically means going to my website, davidrovics.com, clicking on the subscribe button, and basically you get roped into sending me $50 a year, and you get CDs in return, and you get free passes to all my shows, and also a guitar lesson, and all sorts of other exciting things. So if you are one of these people who are gainfully employed or on a decent pension or whatever, and you want to do that, then it's very much appreciated. That's pretty much the only reason I made it from Japan to Australia when I didn't get into New Zealand, was because of people being supportive like that, because it's not a lucrative way to make a living, and there's no plan B when shit like that happens, except for you, basically. Whether or not you are one of the gainfully employed people, all of this music, all of my songs are on the web for free download. You'll find them all at davidrovics.com. And I did that on purpose. It's a business strategy. Might or may not be a good business strategy.
Step three is finding there's a tactic when everyone believes it could be true. That if all the people work collectively, there just might be something we can do, and everything can change. So quick. Businessmen and congressmen and TV sets will try hard to make sure it isn't so. You don't have a problem. And if you do, it's not the singing problem. And if it is, well, there's just nowhere you can go. But it's happened many times. The history is rich, so we easily forget how a meme can take hold and grab you, how it can spread out like a net, and everything can change. About how we don't know what we meant, about how there most certainly isn't any such thing as the 99%, but everything can change. So quick. Everything can change. So quick.
wrote the song 16 years ago.
And I woke one morning, there was a feeling in the air. Everything was quiet, things were different everywhere. The Wobblies were back again with Joe Hill at the mic. Well, the minimum wage workers went on strike. There was no one flipping burgers. All the grills were cold. Onion rings were in their bags. Fries were growing mold. There were no baristas at Starbucks asking how many shots would you like. When all the minimum wage workers went on strike, there was no one pumping gasoline, no one driving from town to town.
No one to load the trucks. Corn was rotting on the stalk. No farm hands to shuck. Workfare workers were hanging at home, spending the day with their tanks. Well, the minimum wage workers went on strike. Yuppie parents were housebound. Their nannies left the job. Walmart workers said enough of our labor has been robbed. The Foot Locker was locked up. The boss had to take a hike. Well, the minimum wage workers went on strike. Well, the minimum wage workers went on strike.
And it's all becoming clear when they're gunning down our comrades, and it seems the end is near as they're loading up the launchers for the tear gas grenades. We can take off our bandanas and kiss behind the barricades when it's madness all around and you can see this at a glance. We will sing and we will cry, we will laugh and we will dance as they shout their marching orders beneath the helicopter blades. We shall seize the moment for a kiss behind the barricades. They will try to break our spirit, and at times they may succeed, but our love for the world is stronger than their greed. When the building is surrounded and hope begins to fade, in my final hour, a kiss behind the barricades. As the movement grows, there will be hills and bends, but at the center of the struggle are your lovers and your friends. And the more we hold each other up, the less we can be swayed. Here's to love and solidarity, and a kiss behind the barricades.